Welcome everybody to A2PC. Today we've got section 3.2, logarithmic functions and their graphs. And here you can see a young man using drumsticks on a fallen tree. I guess you could call that, that's right, a logarithm. All right, so we've touched on this just very, very briefly in one of the early days of the class. And here's what a logarithm looks like. So we've got the notation log, meaning it's a logarithm. Then it has this little number here written as a subscript that's called the base of the logarithm, just like a base of an exponential. And then there's going to be something that follows. Usually it's in parentheses. Sometimes it will be an expression, but that is called the argument of the logarithm. And then a logarithm is going to output typically some type of number, just like a function will output some type of a number. So first, how do we read this expression that is a logarithm? Well, if I would read that, I would say this is log base 3 of 52. That argument is just like it was a function, like f of x, log base 3 of 52. Okay, and how do we think of log base 3 of 52? Well, the logarithm with a base of 3 and an argument of 52 is the perfect exponent to turn the base of 3 into the 52 that's in the argument. So where our exponential function was telling us, hey, now your input is an exponent, right? That's what we talked about yesterday, like 3 to the x equals 52. We would say the same thing, like x is the perfect power to put on 3, but this is an exponential expression. Now we can write that this other way that says, hey, this is the perfect exponent. So this will output the perfect exponent instead of us inputting the perfect exponent. So it's really, really neat because what it allows us to do is take an expression like log base b of a equals x and say, hey, this is saying the same thing as the base of b. If I put that x on there because the perfect exponent equals x, it will become a. So we're able to kind of swap between an exponential and a logarithmic expression. And the reason these are so closely related is that they will undo or invert one another. And so another way of thinking of a logarithm is it's the inverse of an exponential, provided that they have the same base. So you know how when you were first learning algebra and you said, oh, I've got x plus 3 equals 7. If I wanted to undo this plus 3, you learn the inverse operation. You say, oh, I'm going to subtract 3 from both sides, and that's how you solve. And that's how you've learned a lot of algebra along the way. Now we can say, hey, if I've got 3 to the x equals 52, and you use our example here, if I want to undo an exponential base of 3, then I'll use a logarithmic base of 3 on both sides, and the logarithm with that base of 3 cancels out that exponent with that base of 3. X is equal to log base 3 of 52. So that's kind of how they work, from like an inverting, undoing one another. And we'll definitely touch on this a lot more when we get to section 3.4 and we use logarithms to solve. But this is the underlying idea of how they undo one another. All right, now, this chapter uses a calculator quite a bit. So it has some logarithm keys on it. So if you look at the front of your calculator, you'll see LOG. That's understood to be a log base 10. If you know anything about maybe chemistry class, if you're in there, you'll see like 1.39 times 10 to the fifth. Scientific notation uses 10 to some power a lot. So it's very nice to have a log with a base of 10 to undo an exponential base of 10. So that's called a common log. And then it also has this ln key, which really represents ln is log with a base of e. They mean the same thing. And it's called ln because it has a natural base. We said that e was the base of continuous or natural growth. That's what that means here. All right, and if you go into your calculator, if you have a newer TI-84, if you hit the math key and scroll all the way down that list, it's actually easier to scroll up so it kind of cycles back to the bottom. Option A is something called log base. And when you type that, or when you select that option, it will give you a logarithm where you can type any base and any argument, and it will do that calculation. So your calculator is able to handle a lot of these. We could type in log base 3 of 52 using this log base, and it would output the answer for us. All right, so that concept that we just covered on the last slide is what I call the definition of a logarithm. There's a lot of syllables there, so I just call it deflog for short. So here in this first example, we're just going to say, hey, what is this expression telling us? And you'll notice there's no x to solve for or anything here. We're just rewriting it in exponential form. So this is saying the perfect exponent to put on a 16 and turn it into an 8 is 3/4. So I have my base of 16, I put that perfect exponent, which is or equals 3/4, and I will get an 8 as an output. And if we're skeptical, we could type this into a calculator using the caret key and stuff, and we'd see that they in fact are equivalent. Our job was just to rewrite. For 64, remember ln is a log base e of e to the third, and that equals 3. And here you can kind of see, oh, I've got a logarithm with a base e, and inside is an exponential base e. There should be some cancellation, right? They're inverses. Deflog shows us that for sure. Okay, so I've got a base of e. The perfect exponent is 3 to create the argument, which is e to the third, right? That's what's inside that logarithm. There you have it. I mean, it doesn't get any easier than that. All right, now, it's a little bit tougher to work the other way. In other words, if I start off with an exponential, it's a little bit tougher to see all the things that go into place. So let's just start writing a logarithmic equation here. So I want to turn exponential into a log. Okay, I got a log. Okay, here I see a base to a power, 9 to the 3/2 power. So the log with a base of 9, and then after I put on the perfect exponent, it turns into a 27. That perfect exponent was a 3/2 power. For 74, ooh, this is a little bit interesting because I've got 1 over e to the 4th. That's e to the negative 4th. Equaling that 0.0183 and so on. So I'm thinking, okay, I've got a log. My exponential base is e, and the perfect exponent's a negative 4, and it turns into a 0.0183 dot, dot, dot. And so that stuff equals negative 4 because the perfect exponent, the logarithm, equals a negative 4. And this would be considered unsimplified because log base e, we have a simplified way of writing a log with a natural base. So we would transfer that to an ln natural log. Example two, here we are evaluating logarithms. And so evaluate, you know, when we're talking about a function here, you can see this is a logarithmic function. G of x is the logarithm base 16 of x. Okay, so if I plug in a 1/4 for x, I find that g of 1/4 is equal to log base 16 of 1/4. Ooh, okay, and it looks like I should be able to simplify this to some answer. Okay, so let's see, I'm thinking 16 with some perfect power on it will become a 1/4. So 16 to what power is going to turn into 1/4? Well, I know to turn 16 into a 4, I take its square root. Right, so I'm thinking, okay, square root of 16 is going to equal 4. And a square root is a 1/2 power. But I want to turn this into a 1 over 4, not a 4. So I got it now. 16 to the negative 1/2 power would make 1 over 4. So g of 1/4 is going to equal negative 1/2. That's the logarithm. That's the perfect exponent to put on a base of 16 and create a 1/4. And we could always check in a calculator, right? But thinking through the pattern, the definition of a logarithm here is going to be really crucial, especially as we get started. All right, next it says use properties of logarithms to simplify this expression. Again, the major property that we're using right here is the fact that a logarithm will act as an inverse with an exponential. So here, let's just read through this out loud, and it makes so much sense when you hear it spoken aloud. I've got an exponential base of 6, and I'm raising that to the perfect exponent to turn 6 into 36x. Well, that's telling me that 6 to that perfect exponent power is going to create 36x. Again, we have that exponential base and log with the same base. They act as inverses. They cancel anything out. This exponent will turn 6s into 36x's, and that's exactly the exponent I put on a base of 6. That's generally a pattern. If I have b, some exponential base to the log base b of y, it's going to just turn into y because I've got the perfect exponential base with the perfect exponent on it. That inverse can act. All right, number 40 is actually a little easier because with this one here, I've got, notice this is a normal 1/4 out front. That's just like a coefficient. 1/4 times the perfect exponent that turns 4s into 16s. And hopefully we don't have to look at this too long to realize that, hey, that logarithm, the perfect exponent to turn 4s into 16s is just a second power. So that whole logarithm just represents a 2. And I'm taking 1/4 times 2. It's just going to be 1/2. And we'll actually learn some other ways that we can manipulate later on when we get into section 3.3, which is pretty nice. Okay, so what have we learned so far? A logarithm is a perfect exponent. And in that regard, a logarithm will invert an exponential function, provided that they have the same base. So now let's look at logarithms as functions. Now down here in the bottom left, I'm just going to throw down an exponential function. And let's just say that this is y equals 2 to the x. I think that's what we used in 3.1. Here you can see we've got a logarithmic function. I'm just going to copy that one down. Like so. Let's say this is log base 2 of x. And I chose 2 for a base in both of these because if you remember from chapter 1, we said that a function and its inverse will be perfectly symmetrical about the line y equals x. That's the relationship we're seeing here. But even more so, that we can kind of extrapolate from this, our exponential functions had a horizontal asymptote. What happens when I flip x and y when I go to find the inverse? Well, that asymptote that was y equals 0, now that becomes an asymptote of x equals 0. It's vertical. So logarithms have vertical asymptotes. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. And then instead of racing up towards positive y's, now our logarithms will race right towards positive x's. So this idea of flipping x and y is something that will really help tie all this together as we learn about what these logarithms look like as functions. All right, so just as we covered exponential functions, I'm kind of looking at them from a transformation standpoint. Where's the input and all that stuff? What's going to apply the parabolic charades transformations? So first we have this a out front. That doesn't change really for any family of functions. That will apply any type of vertical stretch, shrink, or flip. Okay, same rules apply as when we first learned transformations. The base of the logarithm, that does nothing to stretch or shrink or adjust the graph. It just kind of sets what type of exponential function this logarithm is the inverse of. Okay, again, we have a c value grouped inside with x. You can see the x is the argument place of the logarithm. That's kind of our input area. This will handle any horizontal stretch, shrink, or flip. H is going to give us any shift to the left or to the right, or a translation. Okay, and as you can tell, this is kind of the one that, just like it was K, when our, is our output area, our vertical adjustments on exponentials that determine the asymptote. Now when we flip X and Y, it's this shift left and right. It's this X value that determines the vertical asymptote. So you can imagine if I shift this graph, this log base 2 of x graph to the right, it's also going to move the vertical asymptote to the right. So the vertical asymptote will happen where the argument equals zero. What x value makes that happen? So it's going to be x equals something. What makes the argument zero? Okay, and then lastly, k, that's a shift up or down translation, as we've seen before. Now, thinking about graphing, we kind of talked about the pattern that we saw with exponentials. So here I'm going to say that this blue graph is, for sake of continuity, we'll say it's log base 2 of x. You'll notice that the argument is just an x, so it would have a vertical asymptote where x equals 0. And we kind of see that shape forming there. Now, if I'm going to plot points, I want to think of what are good x values to go in with a log base 2, a base of 2 to turn into something. So I'm thinking of good values as being like log base 2 of 4. Because then when I plug in an x of 4, I get an output of, hey, I know that to turn 2 into 4, the perfect exponent is 2. Another good one would be log base 2 of 1, because I know that to put on a base of 2 and turn it into a 1, it has to be a 0, so the point 1 comma 0. Okay, and then we said 4 comma 2. Another good one would be to match the base exactly, because to turn a base of 2 into 2, I just have put a first power on there, so I've got the point 2, 1. And then, let's see, we had 3, 4. But let's take a look at what's happening. You notice how that racing off to the right, here I notice that, hey, my height is a 1, I'm going that base off to the right from the vertical asymptote. And then I'm going off the base squared to the right now. So it's kind of using that same idea. And we actually have an example that kind of models this for us. But it's that movement off to the right, because now it's racing off to those really high x values. All right, so again, we're just kind of uncovering patterns here and just getting a feel for how the shapes of these graphs are determined. So hey, here is that example that I was referring to. So first, let's graph f of x. I'll do this in red, 4 to the x power. So we've got a horizontal asymptote of y equals 0. We've already been through graphing this. That was a long YouTube video in its own right. We have the point 0, 1. We got the point 1, 4. And we got the point 2 would be 16, which would be somewhere maybe, I don't know, up here. And negative 1, 1 over 4. So here is our 4 to the x. That's f. And then g is going to be log base 4 of x. So again, we're going to kind of play dumb here, because some of you might be using that inverse to really grip and rip this. I'm going to choose my x values very carefully. So I want to have 4 turn into 1 fourth, because the perfect exponent to turn 4 into 1 fourth is a negative 1. I'm going to choose an x value of 1, because to turn a base of 4 into 1, I would put a 0 power. 0 is the perfect exponent there. I'm going to choose a 4, because to turn a base of 4 into 4, I would put on a perfect exponent of 1. And I'm going to choose the x value of 16, because to put a base of 4 and apply some perfect exponent and make a 16, it would have to be a 2. So let's see what happens when we plot those points. My argument would be 0 when x equals 0. I've got the point 1 fourth, negative 1. I've got the point 1, 0, 4, 1, and then 16, 2 would be way off the graph to the right. I really want to show that logarithm graph, just like with exponentials, extending all the way to the bottom. I don't want to give the impression that it just stops. And actually, some calculators, if you were to try and graph log base 4 of x, they'd make a little loop and they actually stop because they get so close to the asymptote the calculator rounds inappropriately. All right, so here is g of x. And again, the reason that they're graphed on the same plane is so that we can observe the symmetry that's happening, and sure enough, there's our line y equals x. Perfect symmetry, confirming yet again that they're inverses of one another. And just here, our inputs were the exponents. Here, the output is the perfect exponent. So the roles of input and output, x and y, are flipped. You could use a calculator for this and get your tables that way, but I strongly encourage you to just kind of think, hey, if I'm graphing a logarithm, I want to think, what is the perfect exponent? What is, that relationship? How can I make log base 4? Oh, I'm going to choose a 1/4 for my input. I've got a base of 4 in my logarithm. I'm going to choose a 1. I'm going to choose a 4. And I'm going to choose a 16. And again, it's because we know that those are going to be nice outputs. It's just that understanding of how they play together that really, really makes a difference. So I hope we get some practice out of that on this assignment. All right. Example 4, you can see I call this example 6 in the notes because some of the slides had more than one on them. But find the domain, the vertical asymptote, and the x-intercept of this and sketch a graph. I wanted us to go through the process of doing a really nasty one by hand because I think that if we can analyze one completely on our own, free from technology, that we walk away so much stronger having thought through this. So I actually give you, and they're not going to be this difficult, but I give you a few problems on a worksheet to do that. I want us to practice this skill because it's going to pay off huge in the long run, just in terms of overall understanding. So, okay, we're going to use a table of values to do this at its core. First thing I want to identify is where's my vertical asymptote? Okay, so here we've got a log base 2. I'm only concerned about the argument for vertical asymptote. So that vertical asymptote, what value of x would zero out this? And it's if x were to equal -1/2. So -1/2 is where our vertical asymptote is. Try and make a pretty clean one on the tablet here. So I know that all my x values should be either all to the left or all to the right of this one. And it looks like because we have no horizontal reflection here, they should all be going to the right. This graph will be racing off to the right, either going up and to the right or down and to the right. Now let's think about what our good x values are going to be. What do I want to show up inside a log base 2? So now as we come up with our x values, we're only looking at the logarithm part, only at the perfect exponent part. We'll deal with that times a -3 and then +2 afterwards. But for my x's, I really like it if this were 2 to the 1/2, right? So what would make 2x plus 1 equal 1/2? Okay, that's going to be my first x value. And I'll try and alternate colors here so it's a little bit coordinated. Next, I want 2x plus 1 to equal a 1. Because if this were a 1 for an argument, I know that that would be 2 to the 0 power, right? I know that would make the logarithm come out clean. Next, I would want to make 2x plus 1 equal a 2. What's that x value going to be? Because again, if this were a 2 inside, 2 to the first would be the 1 would be the perfect exponent, right? And let's do one more. 2 to the x plus 1, that stuff inside, I want that to make a 4 in there. Because I know then the logarithm will be 2 to the second power. 2 is the perfect exponent to make a 4 inside. So we're just kind of thinking through only in the input area, only in the argument of the logarithm, 2x plus 1 equals 1/2. If I subtract 1, I'd be a -1/2. And then I divide by 2, that would be -1/4. That's my first x value. If I subtract 1 and divide by 2, then I'd want 0 for an input. Okay, and that's kind of nice because if we had to look for intercepts, the y-intercept happens when x equals 0. That's kind of cool. All right, next, we'll go back to red. Subtract 1 and divide by 2, a +1/2. Okay, and then lastly, subtract 1 and divide by 2, that would be 3/2. So those are my really, really smart inputs. And now when I go to look at their outputs, I'm going to do a little scratch work off to the side. We knew that an x value of negative 1/4 is making this in the logarithm. That means the entire expression, 2 minus 3 times, okay, the perfect exponent to turn 2 into 1/2 is a negative 1. So I've got 2 plus 3. That makes sense. The entire logarithm turns into this negative 1 because we know how to handle it. We know what was being made in the argument, and we know the relationship with the base that does that. Let's try the next one. Let's look for a pattern. So I've got 2 minus 3 times the perfect exponent to turn a base 2 into a 1. And here's what we... Well, that's going to be a 0 power. So I've got 2... minus 0, it's just 2. Next one, 2 minus 3 times the perfect power that will turn a 2 into a 2. And you see the pattern that we're forming here? I got negative 1, then 0, then 1. There should be a little bit of a pattern there if you've set these up nicely. It does require a little bit of foresight. But I think after a little bit of practice, we can find out how good we are at this. Next, 2 minus 3 times, let's see, I made a 4 in my argument. To turn a base 2 into a 4, that would be a second power. 2 minus 6, negative 4. And take a look at what we're seeing in our outputs as well. So we're seeing from 5 down to 2, down to negative 1, down to negative 4. See how we're subtracting 3 each time? This is a logarithm that usually goes down 1 each time if we'd chosen these values wisely. Now this shows that that is a vertical flip and 3 times as tall. We're going down 3 each time. Very cool. So if I plot those points, I'm at negative 1/4 and I'm up at a height of 5, right about there. When x is 0, we've got a height of 2. When x is 1/2, we've got a height of negative 1. Ooh, that's going to be an interesting y-intercept, won't it? Or x-intercept, I mean. Our y-intercept came up right in our table. And then at 4, we're at negative 4. And so here, this worked out really nicely. If we needed to go back and choose more smart x values, we could go and certainly choose more powers of 4. We can see our graph racing off to the right, racing upwards towards the vertical asymptote. There we have it. All right, so find the domain. The domain of this is going to go from wherever that vertical asymptote was, negative 1/2. It's not going to include it. We're going to come right up to it, though, and it's going to go to the right towards positive infinity. The range for this one, if we look at the graph, I know we weren't asked to find it, but the range of any logarithm graph should be all real numbers. Provided we don't have anything other than like a linear argument area. If this were like an x squared, that may change things. Okay, the last thing to find is the x-intercept, and that's going to be the fun one, because the x-intercept happens when y equals 0. So 0 equals 2 minus 3 log base 2 of 2x plus 1. How in the world am I going to have not be able to figure this out? Well, let's go ahead and isolate the logarithm, right? Because I know that that means the perfect exponent. So that's where my x is located as well. Let's subtract 2 and divide away the negative 3. So minus 2 divided by negative 3. Okay. Now I'm getting somewhere, because the definition of a logarithm says that if I take that base of 2 and put the perfect exponent of 2/3 on it, it will turn into the argument, the 2x plus 1. Okay, and then I subtract 1 and divide by 2, so my x-intercept is hideous here. But again, I made this one to be brutal on purpose. So we have all the skills to solve this one, which is really, really neat to see it come together. So this is the cubed root of 2 to the second, and then I would subtract 1 and divide by 2. That would be x. All right, so up here where I've got a little bit more room, the x-intercept is the point cubed root of 4 minus 1 all over 2, comma 0. And we could figure out the decimal for that. Hopefully it would be something that would just be mildly positive, right? Something around 1/4 to confirm that if needed. All right, here's a look at your assignment. The graphing worksheet only has a couple problems on it, just so that we can acclimate ourselves to kind of like that find the perfect exponent, right? Think through the definition of a logarithm, and then a smattering of odds where you're looking at the inverse relationships and such, transformations. All right, the only other additional note is if they ask you to graph using transformations, please don't bother. Don't bother graphing on any identify the transformations problems. Sometimes I believe that they don't ask you to graph these, but if the instructions say identify the transformations and then graph, don't bother graphing those problems. We want to get accustomed to where's the input area, where's the output area of these functions, but at a certain point there's just too much graphing involved. It's too much of a time drain for us. So please keep that in mind. I'm pretty sure when I looked at the assignment, they just asked for transformations on those, but just to be clear. I hope you've enjoyed this section. Logarithms are really, really exciting and some of my favorite types of problems to do. So I'm having a lot of fun this chapter. I hope you are too. Thank you for watching.